Erik, after you won Emmys for From the Earth to the Moon and Band of Brothers, you ended up in a position where you began to pitch ideas. Can you tell us about that period of your life?
Yeah. So there was a certain point where I kind of had a little bit of a name in terms of being a writer that my agents could get out there to pitch, based especially after Band of Brothers. And I signed at a certain point. I transitioned from a small agency to CAA, which is the biggest agency. And I had these, you know, pretty aggressive agents in the TV literary department who were like, you know, we can get you out on meetings and, you know, you can pitch ideas to, you know, networks and try and create your own series. So for several years, that was kind of my main focus. I had a few jobs where I worked on staff on other people's shows, but it was really come up with an idea, email the idea like in a 2 or 3 sentence log line to my agent, and then wait for a response and see if they think it's worth doing anything with. What I really learned was a lot of it, once you have an agent, if you're trying to go pitch ideas, or even if you're just writing on spec, they wanna know that it's a worthwhile idea before that, you know, you're gonna pursue it further, or they're gonna send it out or send you out with it. So what I really learned a lot about was what makes a viable TV series idea, because I was doing it for a living and I was coming up with all these ideas, and most of them my agents weren't that interested in, and they would shoot down for various reasons. So it was like, I have to first get it past my own representatives, my own employees, so to speak. But I understood why, because their reputation hinges on they're only bothering people with ideas from clients that they actually think really have a chance, right? So it doesn't look good for them if a studio or producer keeps getting phone calls from them saying, you got to read this script or hear this pitch, and it's something they don't like. So I learned, and eventually there would be an idea that they would like, just that little logline version. And then they would set me up on meetings with production companies, you know, pods, producer overall deals, that they would represent, the agency would represent all these different production companies that had deals at different studios. And, you know, sometimes I would go out and pitch the same idea to a different producer at every single one of the like 5 or 6 studios, and hopefully they would like it. And if somebody liked it, then the next step is you pitch it to the studio that they are affiliated with, and if the studio likes it, then you would pitch it to network. And studios usually like to pitch to their sister networks if they have one, which most of them do these days. So there was a lot of, you know, first we got to go to our home network, and then if they don't buy it, then you can go to the other networks. So, you know, so it's a lot of swings and misses when you're doing that, I think for most people, where, you know, the ideas you have that your agents like, you may not get a producer that likes, or your producer may like it, but you can't sell it to a network. Like, but if you go the whole distance and the network likes it, then they pay you to write a pilot script. And that's kind of like the whole goal initially, is to get a deal to write a pilot where they're paying you. All you've done is come up with a pitch, and you know they're going to pay you to write it as you go, which means they have a certain amount of control over it, because now they own it and they're going to give you notes all along the way. But as a writer who's always writing on spec and may or may not sell anything, it's great to actually be paid while you're doing it. So that was kind of my first experience of that, other than working on those miniseries.
Did you think it was going to be, or your pitches would be received differently coming off the success of these two shows? Did you feel that it would have been easier, or was it actually less difficult than you imagined?
No, it was definitely harder than I imagined. When I first started pitching ideas for series, I had no idea what I was doing. And I just came up with these ideas without any real knowledge. I mean, I'd watched TV my whole life. I'd won 2 Emmys for these miniseries on HBO, but those were very different from a like normal drama series, right? An ongoing, you know, scripted series that isn't based on history is very different from a miniseries based on history. So what I learned pitching to my agents at CAA, whether it was a full sit down, here's my lengthy idea, or a short log line in an email, was that they didn't like most of the ideas I came up with. And they would tell me, I remember one of my agents said once, you know, they're gonna think you don't really understand television if you pitch an idea like this. I was like, what? So it was a big learning curve for me and it really helped me realize for the first time, I may have to come up with a lot of different ideas that I actually spend some time on to get to one that the professionals who represent me are gonna like enough to wanna send out to the industry.
And remind me again, what does PODS stand for?
So a POD is a producer overall deal, which just means a production company that has a deal with one of the studios, whether it's for features or TV or both. And so as a writer, when you pitch something to your agents and they like it, usually the first step is they want to then have you pitch it to one of the pods that that agency represents.
If you had to put a number on the amount of ideas that you pitched, what would that number be?
If it included ideas that I just had like a 2 or 3 sentence log line that I sent to my agents or somebody, dozens and dozens for sure, you know, maybe 100, maybe a little less than that.
And those were mostly post-Emmy or?
Yeah. I mean, I wasn't really in a position where anybody was interested in me pitching anything before those two miniseries that established me as a writer. So there were no opportunities or interest, but once you're established enough that you've done something people think is good and you know, if you've won awards, that's helpful, then suddenly it's like, okay, do you have ideas? Or if you've worked on something successfully for many years, like on staff of a series, and you've, you know, risen up, you know, in the food chain of the series to a higher level over a period of years, that's when the studios and the networks and the agents even start to be more interested in you as somebody who might have your own idea for a show. So I didn't have any interest in me for that until after Band of Brothers. But then I had a lot of interest and a lot of people were interested in meeting me and so forth. And so I became kind of like a flavor of the month there for a while, where I was being sent out to meet with all these different executives and production companies, sometimes just for general meetings, like, who are you? Nice to meet you. What kind of stuff do you want to do? And then sometimes pitch meetings where I have an official idea that I'm coming in to talk to them about. So most of the ideas I would pitch to my agents would die there and they wouldn't send me out with them anywhere. But the ones that they liked, then I would end up with a production company. And then sometimes you make relationships with those people and they want to know what else you have, and you kind of get the ball rolling. But what I learned was it really does start with your representative, whether you have a manager, an agent, or both. If they don't like it, it's probably not going anywhere. So you kind of have to impress them first. And sometimes they're the toughest ones to impress, I felt.
When you would go out on the meetings that were just sort of like a meet and greet, did you realize like the impact that those quick meetings would have? Did you realize they were kind of like sizing you up to see, is this someone we can work with, whether his ideas are brilliant or not?
You know, those kind of general meetings, some people jokingly call them free water, because that's the only thing that ever comes of it, is you get a free bottle of water while you're sitting there and having a meeting, because they can seem pointless. They can seem like it's just a, hi, how are you? Nice to put a face to the writing sample we read, or the script, the project we saw that you wrote, or whatever. So they seem a little bit vague sometimes, the general meetings, if you don't have anything to pitch. It's probably always better if you have some things you're working on that you can refer to obliquely without really pitching them, so that they'll be like, oh, that sounds kind of interesting. When you've worked that out, let's hear more about that, you know. But I never knew what came of those general meetings, other than I suppose there were some where my agents were like, oh, they really liked you, and when we have something to pitch, they're definitely going to be on the list of someone to take it to. So I suppose for them, there is a little bit of a screening process. The production company, they want to know that you're good in a room, you know, that you're articulate, that you're somebody that they think could pitch something successfully to a network, because obviously that's part of the job. So I suppose they're auditioning me for that, but I wasn't really super aware of what exactly was going on.
Maybe that's part of the magic. Yeah. Here he is. He's coming.
The waters were great. Sometimes right. I got Diet Coke, sometimes regular Coke.
Oh, good.
There were more than one option is what I'm saying, which was nice.
That's great. How long did this pitching phase of your life last? Or is it still going on?
Well, I mean, in theory, it could happen at any time, but there was a period where I was really actively doing that, which was kind of like, I would say, probably like a 5-year period or so, like after Band of Brothers and kind of pre-strike. And I remember that I sold a pitch right before the strike and was writing the script when we went on strike. And then that project didn't happen because the strike kind of, they like kind of killed a lot of deals during the strike. So I kind of see that as a demarcation period. And that was leading up to that was a period where I was really doing that as my main focus, pitching 1-hour TV ideas. And they were always lighter comedic 1 hours because I always felt I was a comedy person. My start was in comedy, and then I became known for this very dramatic historical stuff, which meant I could be sold into the industry writing that, but I never really wanted to like write legal dramas and stuff like that. So I was always pitching ideas that were kind of like almost too comedic to be a 1-hour. And maybe that's why they didn't, you know, I didn't sell as many as I might have, because I wasn't really a procedural writer or like a dark, thrillery, drama type of writer. The kind of stuff I was pitching at that time, there wasn't necessarily a lot of those kind of shows with that kind of tone on the air. Also, they probably weren't the greatest ideas. I'm not going to say that it was just because it was the wrong fit, but yeah, about 5 years.
What was the biggest takeaway? Whether it's just take the water if you're offered, or what was the biggest lesson from that?
Well, probably the biggest takeaway is really what eventually led to this book I wrote called The Idea, which is that you got to come up with a lot of ideas to come up with one that you could actually sell, or that would sell if you wrote the script. Because I really did see that this isn't easy at all. I mean, you can look at TV and go, oh, there's all these different kind of TV shows. I can just come up with an idea for a show and it's a viable idea. All I have to do is write it or get the right person to hear it. And I mean, I wasn't probably that naive, but I was more naive than I am now, because I really learned that it's a lot of work to develop an idea for a show, and chances are they're gonna say, yeah, here's why that isn't going to work, or why we're not that interested, or why there have been other shows kind of like that, or that either were successful and so you're coming too late to the party, or they weren't successful, which shows us that kind of show doesn't really work. And so probably the biggest takeaway was just like, yeah, this isn't easy. I see why, you know, you get paid pretty well when you break through with something, but it's very very easy to have a lot of lean times where you're not selling anything, even though you're working at it pretty hard.
Do you almost think it was better that you didn't know? Just because some people, when they know what the odds are, they won't try something. You know, very bright people, but they just feel like, well, it's not even worth trying.
Well, there was no way that I was going to not try it, because at that point I had reached a real height. I mean, I just won my second Emmy and had these two big miniseries. And I'd worked with Tom Hanks for years, and he still had projects for me to like do with him and stuff at Playtone. So it wasn't like, there was no chance I was going to be afraid to try. It was more like, oh, they want to hear my ideas now. Great. Okay, I'll come up with ideas. And then it was like a little humbling that, oh, it isn't so easy. But it wasn't like a fear of trying going in. I was just kind of like, great, I'm Mr. Impressive Hollywood writer now that people want to work with. So I'll come up with some ideas and we'll see where it goes. I wasn't super confident, but I wasn't like scared of it, I would say, because it was more like good things are happening. Oh, okay, let's do this now. Great, exciting.